Welcome everyone to another CH2 replay cast. This time we're gonna have a 2v2, as you can already see on Moscow Outskirts Winter, and it's going to be between Fionn, I'm guessing that's how you say this name, Fionn, playing as Wehrmacht, and he only had Osttruppen Doctrine, by the way, in the loadouts, so this is gonna be interesting. He's clearly that's what he wants to do, and we'll see exactly how he does it, and it's gonna be very interesting to see. Now, his friend is gonna be Burt, playing as the OKW, and on the enemy team we're gonna have Lyconius and Havoc, both from the RTN, remember the name, clan. And already from that, but also from the fact that Fionn, who sent in the replay, told me so, I know that since there's RTN, I already know that this 2v2 is going to be a pretty good quality, because usually RTN players are just pretty good players. And indeed, this is a top 100 arranged team 2v2 game, so it's going to be pretty interesting to see. Now, you already see a Kubuwagen out of Burt, and both Fionn and Burt are going for the left side of the map. Now, Moscow Outskirts Winter is pretty much one of the standard, well, without Winter more, but even the Winter version of Moscow Outskirts is one of the standard 2v2 maps with a pretty huge variety of areas to fight in, and it's a very wide map that allows for a lot of flanking maneuvers, a lot of interesting capping choices, and stuff like that, so it's a pretty always interesting map to play as. But we also see a little bit of interesting play with this Kubuwagen, not really being used to cap around a whole bunch as I would have expected it to. It's instead trying to actually fight these constructs and actually pushing them out of cover, which is a pretty good idea because it allows these Osttruppen and green cover to use their cover bonus to their accuracy to actually deal a lot of damage to these constructs and beat them despite their inferiority. And it's probably going to be pretty easily repaired by these pioneers if it stops moving, since it was actually just moving like a little dick. Now, we do see free Osttruppen out of Fionn, and he's also gone for an MG42 out of his HQ. No tier 1 yet for him, which means that his Osttruppen don't have the Panzerfaust yet, because it requires the infantry company to use. We'll see if later on this actually comes into play against them, if the allies go for any light vehicles. We do see free rifleman squads out of Havoc, and Havoc is trying to gain control of the right side of the map. Sorry for that little sound. He's trying to gain control of the right side of the map with the fuel point, and he's gonna have a pretty good success against these Osttruppen, who were clearly ordered to go and capture the point, but unfortunately, they find some riflemen, and they will be massacred at close range, and unfortunately, it does look like they will be wiped. No, it seems that they may actually escape. Very lucky there to escape. Was a little bit late on the retreat, but it's all good for him, as he will be able to hit that squad. Of course, Osttruppen, even if they get very vetted up, aren't exactly the most effective units. However, it's still nice to keep them alive and keep them vetted, because it's still more expensive to replace the squad than it is to just give them reinforcements. Now, on the left side of the map, the situation is completely different, and Burt has been able to capture these points with his Sturmpiles, and in fact we do see the light vehicle coming in. It is an M3A1 from Lyconius, and he's gonna have a squad of penals in it. Now, the penals in the scout cars is gonna mean that if a Panzerfaust hits this clown car, it's going to damage the engine, and the penals are not going to be able to repair it, unlike the engineers, who will just be able to jump out and repair. And it's not even going to come into play, because the mine, excellent mine placement from the Stern Pioneers, and excellent play with the Stern Pioneers also luring the M3A1 onto the mine by just running away, and now he's going to salvage the M3A1, so adding insult to injury, absolutely great play by Burt, completely actually neutralizing one of the most dangerous threats to Axis players in the early game from the Soviet Tier 1. He's gonna pretty much now only have to face infantry for a while. Now, you do actually see a second M3. I'm not sure if the second M3 was built before the demise of the first one or after, but judging from the fact that it's already on the field, I feel like it was already producing before the other one was dead, because it does take quite a while to actually get that on the field. Now, we do have a Raketenwerfer out of Burt. It's over here by the cutoff point and sort of the German side of the map, but it is ready to actually face allied light vehicles that come in later. So, of course, if it's actually going to be repositioned to somewhere where it's useful, for example, over here facing the munitions point, then it will be a pretty nasty surprise for any allied vehicles that approach. Now, this Rifleman squad has been able to capture the victory point as well, and it's also capturing the strategic point right outside the base of the Germans. However, you see a flamethrower from Fionn that's actually going to be pretty damn dangerous to it, especially thanks to this light cover that it's gonna take if this guy decides to move up, and it's gonna actually take light cover. Still, these riflemen are taking quite a lot of damage from that flamer, because they were quite clumped up, and the flamer is pretty damn effective against these riflemen early on into the game. Unfortunately, at this kind of medium range, the riflemen can hit back pretty sort of heavily. However, I feel like the flamethrower might win this engagement, and it's gonna force, in fact, the riflemen onto retreat, especially as there was an MG42 coming up from the south. Now, the second clown car has already started its sort of campaign of destruction, and it looks like has done a little bit of damage, perhaps to these stern piles. Yeah, it's got one kill and a lot of damage done against the stern pioneer squad. Unfortunately for the Germans, there's nothing else protecting this fuel point from the wrath of the clown car, so the decapturing will be pretty easy. And actually, this one rifleman squad is in pretty big trouble, as there's 12 Ostruppen shooting at him, and despite the fact that the Ostruppen can't hit shit, that's still a lot of rifles, especially if they go into the negative cover and Fionn keeps chasing with both of his squads. Unfortunately for the Allies, only one squad chases, but that one squad is enough to wipe out that rifleman. And that was a vetted rifleman squad, so that sort of hurts doubly because, of course, without the veteran one, you cannot throw in stun grenades. And at this point in the game, it's already early enough so that the 2-2-2 is on the field. So Fionn will be able to actually utilize that squad wipe to pretty great effect. And now that the tiers are built, the Ostruppen can use the Panzerfaust, and they will use the Panzerfaust to great effect to destroy the M3A1. However, at this point, pretty good play by Lyconius actually getting out of the clown car before it was taken out, and so allows his penal squad to be at full strength and able to easily force back these two German squads. Now, we do see actually a Doctrine selection, Partisans, actually out of Lyconius, and that's going to be pretty good at countering any kind of German vehicles with the surprise AT Partisans. However, I feel like it was a bit of a rash decision to get it just to have a ET Partisan squad to force back this 2-2-2. Why? Because Lyconius doesn't have anti-tank grenades research, so he could not use the AT Partisans to actually throw an anti-tank grenade and snare the armor car, thus sort of securing the kill on it. So he was only able to force it back. In fact, the Panzerschreck shot actually missed, so he was actually quite unlucky in that regard as well. Now, the VP situation is pretty even at this point. The allies are down to 430, but no one has really gotten any kind of big lead so far on the field, which is good for both sides because that will give them more time to actually sort of flesh out what they're trying to do with this game. And so far, Lyconius does seem to be sort of the more active of the two allied players with the teching. He's already going for a tier 3, whereas Havoc, so far, doesn't look like he's really gone for anything. He does have the captain, but he does have the fuel for the Steward, actually, so I feel like we'll see the Steward quickly enough once Havoc does have the manpower required to actually build that Steward. And the Steward is going to be pretty effective against the double clown car, and it's going to be particularly effective against the Volksgrenadiers because, of course, they can't get Panzerstrecks anymore. So having that Steward to sort of counter-harass German units capturing in the left side of the map, it's going to be really good. Now, good usage of the Partisan troops spawned from the shack is actually going to destroy the MG42 that was defending the northern VP, and it's actually going to steal the machine gun and capture the point, perhaps even lay down a mine if Lyconius is in that mood, because he does have the munitions for a mine. Now, I feel like Lyconius is making a mistake in not upgrading his shield infirmary. Of course, this is because he's using a lot of his manpower spawning these Partisans. This is the main sort of drawback. Actually, one German squad got wiped. Looks like a Pioneer? Yeah, it looks like... No, actually an Ostruppen. I saw the Ostruppen badge. Yeah, an Ostruppen was wiped at the middle VP, so that is a small but decent revenge for the Allies for all the losses they've been taking in these engagements. Now, the Allies are in a little bit of a tough spot right now, but since Havoc was able to get out Steward out, now they do have the armor superiority if Bert doesn't get any kind of German vehicle. For example, a Puma, which he can build. However, I feel like Bert is going to go for the Stuka at this point because of what he knows. At this point, if the Steward shows itself, it's going to be absolutely the best decision to go for a Puma, which might be why he's saving up resources, maybe just to see what the Allies are going to do. However, the Stuka would also be a pretty attractive sort of purchase because the Allies do have quite a lot of infantry, especially Lyconius has a huge amount of infantry squads, and that is going to be very vulnerable to the Stuka. However, now that he sees the Steward, I really feel like Bert should be going for the Puma purchase because that's going to counter the Steward pretty heavily, especially coupled with a Rakenwerfer, which he does have. Now, Ostupern are going to be excellent because of their map control potential. They aren't exactly the most important fighting units, so if you can spread them out and have them capture around in in and around the flanks of the map, it's going to be really, really hard for the allies to deal with so many annoying units just coming at you from all directions. So the Ostupern actually capturing the right side of the map is going to be pretty good for the Axis, because that's going to reinforce the VP lead that they already have, which is not exactly big, but it's already there. And if the Axis can continue the push in that regard, it's going to be a nice addition to their chances of winning. Now, pretty good usage of Partisans actually cloaked behind the truck, firing a nice Panda Trek shot at the 2-2. 2-2 also taking a lot of damage from the Steward, and it's going to go down. But at the same time, the Steward is taking a huge amount of damage from this Reckenwerfer. Reckenwerfer, however, at maximum range, it will be able to get the last shot in and destroy the Steward. Excellent play from Bert, using that camouflaged Reckenwerfer, just as Lyconius used the camouflaged Partisans. However, there's also a new challenger that appears, which is the T-70, which was already in production before this fight started, and so it's able to get out on the field. But at this point, surprise, surprise, there's a Puma as well, and the German Puma will be able to charge in and deal a lot of damage to the T-70. T-70 taking a few pot shots in return against the Puma, but the Puma will not be able to chase, because chasing through this hedgerow and little massive trees is a very bad idea, because it blocks line of sight. So the Germans, before the Ostupern over here were able to sneak into the area, were not actually able to see what was behind. So there might have been an ET Partisan squad in hand, just waiting in ambush with perhaps a mine and some anti-tank grenades. So chasing down with the Puma would have been a terrible decision, and Bert was absolutely right in staying as Anne. Though, if he would have actually chased, he would have gotten the kill on the T-70, barring some RNGs luck. However, it was still the best decision with the information that he had available to hold off on the chase. So that's actually one of the main differences between sometimes when you're casting a game, you need to be always wary that since you have the god eye view of the battlefield with no fog of war, sometimes you don't really know about things that cloud the judgment of some players. So what might have seemed like a bad decision of holding off on the chase, which would have killed the T-70, was actually a really good play, considering the amount of information that Bert had in at his disposal. Now, on the right side of the map, the Ostupern were able to capture the fuel point, which is really good, because right now the Allies are pretty much half the income of the Germans because of this nice harassment maneuver. And at the same time, in the center, they're still losing the fight because of the pretty good unit control out of Bert. Is controlling these units really well. However, he's cloning a huge amount of resources, which is, I feel like, a very big detriment. If I was him, I would definitely go for a Stuka at this point, because it would still be really nice against these allied infantry groups that keep harassing the Germans at every turn and are giving the allies a little bit of a breathing space, managing to always get around their defenses and get around their strong points. Also, with the support of the T-70, this is going to be really bad, because the T-70 is pretty good against the 2-2-2. 2-2-2 alone cannot fight the T-70, and since the second 2-2-2 was destroyed by the Partisans, there is no second 2-2-2 to actually help out in the fight. But the T-70 takes a lot of damage from Panzerfaust of the Ostrupen. The Ostrupen will not be able to actually get past the wall of Allied infantry. What killed the T-70? The Puma, of course, from the south. Very nice play, actually, repositioning the Puma as was needed, using its mobility, and nicely using it to get the second kill onto a allied vehicle this game. So again, that Puma, excellent decision, really paying off for itself. However, the allies have been able to actually get a lot of map control with this infantry push through the center into the north, which is going to be really good for them, because right now they were lacking in map control, and it is going to be crucial for them to actually retain a little bit of map control now that they've lost their light vehicles, which were relying on to get their early game push, However, at this point, they have to rely on their infantry until they can get their medium and heavy armor on the field. They could get heavy armor out of the heavy cavalry company that Havoc does have. Havoc still hasn't selected a commander, perhaps wisely, because he will be able to get the tactical support, or the heavy cavalry commander, or the M10s, however the situation requires. Now, there is the stolen MG42 by the Partisans, as you can see, still supporting their Papa Shah submachine guns, so this is actually a very scary unit for the Soviets, which is right now being quite held up by this one MG42? Is that an MG42? Hold on. No, MG34. Okay. That looked like an MG42 from the top. I was like, what's the OKW doing with MG42? But no, it's MG44. Now, half-track purchase from Lyconius will be used to upgrade to a Zisu quad mount, and I'm not sure about this purchase, to be completely honest. At 14 minutes, when the T-70 has already failed to do anything decisive, I feel like he's trying to use it as a suppression unit, not as a sort of shock wiper. And for it, it's a pretty decent choice. However, it's definitely countered by the Puma, and it's going to definitely be countered by any medium armor that Fien will be soon getting on the field, because he does have the tier 3 research, and he can get some Panzer 4s because he does have the fuel for it. He's just going to be needing the manpower, which he's going to have in a little bit. Now, we actually have a battle group headquarters going in from Bert, who has already gotten his Schwer Panzer headquarters near his base, which is going to mean that he's probably going for a King Tiger at this point, which kind of is good for the Allies in a way, because it's going to give them a lot of breathing room to recover from these mid-game losses that they've suffered. And now that they've sort of recovered their initiative, they've recovered their cohesion, because they've been playing sort of as a team a lot better than they did in the early game, this is going to be really good for them, because it's also going to provide them with an extra window of opportunity to use their half-track to good potential, and potentially to use any kind of American units that later on are going to be a little bit more ineffective in this window, while only the Wehrmacht are getting out some armor. Now, this is also going to be pretty good because there's a captain with bars. Okay, that's actually pretty scary though, because there's two bar. Okay, so let me get this straight. There's two people with Garands. Oh, that's pretty much a lieutenant. Wow, that's actually kind of unexpected, because a lot of players have the sort of, at this point, after so many sort of games against captains that were only good against vehicles, there's kind of knee-jerk reaction of, oh, it's a captain, I can beat it with my SDG Volksgrenadiers, but no, it's got two bars and a Thompson, so it's actually very dangerous against German infantry. It's going to be an interesting way to use the captain. Now, Partisan is actually getting suppressed by a machine gun in the house. The house is actually somehow unscathed. That kind of speaks to the amount which the Germans have managed to defend sort of the left side of the map from Allied incursions, that the cutoff has been completely sort of defended the entire game. There's been no action around the house, which is usually sort of one of the quicker buildings to go down on this map. Only the church goes down quicker than that. Now, there is an SU-76 out in the field from Lyconius. However, it's taking a huge amount of damage from this Panzer IV. Panzer IV will be luckily for the SU-76 repulsed by the bazooka equipped echelons and its M167mm anti-tank gun. And that's going to be pretty good. However, there's some Panzer Grenadiers coming in to try and deal some damage against the AT gun. And that's going to be very dangerous, because the Panzer Trucks can actually deal a lot of damage to the weapon crew once it's decrewed. The weapon, the actual weapon, can take a lot of damage from these Panzer Trucks. However, luckily for Havoc, he had a rifleman spot on standby, so good play by him actually getting his infantry out and sort of helping out his AT crew, allowing the rear echelons to recrew the AT gun. And now, this is actually a pretty good situation for the Allies, because they do have a triple cap going. Now, Fien is trying to recapture the right side of the map, and the left side of the map is sort of deserted. There is a actual Jackson on the field for Havoc. I'm not sure about the Jackson at this point, but it's definitely a pretty good sort of insurance policy against any kind of later German vehicles. Right now, it's mainly going to be useful against the Panzer IV, because the Puma, if it can surprise the Jackson from behind with its superior mobility, it's actually very dangerous to the Jackson. However, the Puma at these sorts of sniping matches obviously isn't that effective against the Jackson, because the Jackson is simply more powerful with its huge main gun. However, the Puma can, again, be sort of a dark horse in that matchup in a 1v1. However, the Jackson will still be very effective against the Panzer IV anyway, so the Panzer IV is going to have to be very careful of where the Jackson is. So it will be nice for the Germans if they could sort of keep tabs on this unit as much as possible, because it's going to be their main sort of worry for now on, until they get fighting against some of the later game American units, which are going to come out fairly soon. Because Havoc is at 8 CPs, which means that if he were to choose Armor Company, which at this point was the Jackson purchase, and with the major tech up, I feel like he's not going to go. Oh, it looks like the half-track is going to go down from the Puma, and there's also a couple of allied vehicles floating around at the same time, so the Puma should definitely be very careful and should run away as quickly as possible. There has been a little bit of engagement in the north center area of the map as well. Now, at this point, we do see some infantry squads duking it out. Unfortunately, it does look like sort of the artillery field officer it sort of has the field for the Germans, but there are a few very dangerous American squads approaching, and I don't feel like these two units will be able to hold against the Americans. So if Havoc can get a little bit of map control back for the Allies on the right side of the map, it's going to be good. They still have the fuel point. The rear echelon should actually be capturing the munitions and should be leaving the job of capturing the victory point to the rifleman squads and the captain. However, it does look like the rear echelons following the rifleman instead of the captain will be unfortunate for Havoc, because the Panzer IV does come in to actually harass the captain. So that will be a pretty expensive thing for Havoc, especially if the captain model goes down, which it looks like he has gone down. So that's going to be 50 manpower just to replenish the captain model. Now, a nice SU-76 barrage. SU-76 is actually up to vet 2 because of its damage that it's done to the Puma, perhaps? I'm not sure. And there's actually a Stuka coming on the field from Bert. I'm not sure about this. I feel like it's a little bit late for the Stuka, but it's never too late for artillery, especially if Jackson goes down to the to the Rakendenwerfer, and there's also an American infantry squad, looks like a rear echelon, going down in the north, thanks to the nice response of the Panzer IV and the German infantry. Maybe they will be able to actually wipe out this veteran C2 rifleman squad with two BARs as well, if the Panzer IV keeps chasing. Ironically, with rear armor facing, it might actually be able to, if it gets a lucky shot from its 75mm main gun, and, oh, actually it hits a mine, very good mine placement from, I'm guessing, the Soviets, because the Americans can actually not place any mines because they haven't gone for Heavy Cavalry Company, which is the only company they have with the mines. And a really nice grenade. Unfortunately, Fien was microing on the right side of the map to actually get his Panzer IV repaired and get the points back under his control. So he could not actually micro away his machine gun from the building in time. And thanks to the nice usage of smoke and grenades, Havoc actually wipes one of the most important assets that the Allies had to, the Axis had to keep the Allied troops at bay on the left side of the map. There is also a Obersoldan squad, which is up to 4 kills now, 5. It's going to be able to easily decrew this AT gun for the Wehrmacht. And that's going to be pretty good if the Germans can get some kind of armor defensive going in time soon. However, I feel like that's not going to be the case. Fien does have a sort of reduced fuel sort of reserve from what I would be expecting at this point in the game. However, I feel like that is because the Allies were pretty good lately in keeping up their harassment of the left side of the map, and also because they were able to capture the cutoff point finally after all this time. And actually, Havoc is going to go for a Sherman, so I feel like this is partially leading up to a tactical support company purchase, because I feel like going so heavily on the tier 3, the major tech, is usually reserved for players that aren't going for armor company or heavy cavalry company, because if you are going for that very expensive Pershing or for a lot of M10s and 105 Sherman, then you're not going to be spending all that much fuel on tier 3 units, perhaps a Jackson, but not much else. And since he's going for a Sherman at this point, oh, actually he's going to cancel the Sherman, which is, I feel like, the better decision, unless he has done something I don't understand. No, he's canceled the Sherman. Okay, that I feel like is a good decision, because I feel like at this point it should be clear that the Germans are going for the later game vehicles, and Fien is going to just be providing the intermediate Panzer IV support along with the sort of infantry support for Bert's later, perhaps Panthers, perhaps King Tiger. Going for a Sherman is not going to be the most effective thing against that, because the main striking forces of the Germans are going to be Panzer IVs for now, against which the Sherman isn't too great, and later on it's going to be the King Tiger against which the Sherman is really bad. Now, a good usage of the SU-76s, along with an AT partisan spawn from the church, actually doing a lot of damage against the Panzer IV. However, Panzer IV using smoke? No, actually artillery officer using smoke. That's not something you see every day. The artillery officer does have a smoke barrage, which is only 30 munitions and is actually pretty quick to fall down. So very nice unit knowledge from Fionn, using a sort of obscure ability that nobody uses from the artillery officer, who has 14 kills and has used concentrated fire, which increases the accuracy and rate of fire of nearby units. He's actually used that to quite good effect. So again, really nice usage of a unit that is not really popular in any way, which is exactly what you want to see from these sort of higher level games. You don't want to be seeing usual meta stuff all the time. Now, mine will deal a little bit of damage against the Vet 5 Volksturnier. I feel like that was a bit of an earlier retreat. He could have used that Vet 5 sort of freeman squad to capture this point right outside the allied base to do a little bit of sort of harassment and sort of cause a little bit of annoyance to the enemy. But there would have also been a pretty sort of dangerous, risky element to that, because of course a freeman Volksturnier squad. What if some kind of Sherman or T-34 or T-7 even comes out of the woodwork and just wipes it? You don't want to be losing that Vet 5 squad, so I absolutely understand the decision of retreating that early. Now, the Axis have managed to get a triple cap going, and while the Allies earlier had a triple cap and managed to reduce the Axis to 250 DPs, the Allies are even in an even worse position, and they are at 202. And right now, they don't really, unlike the Axis earlier, who had the sort of units already going back to capture the points as soon as the triple cap was in effect, the Allies are still sort of mustering up and replenishing their forces at base. So they don't really have anything ready to sort of counterattack immediately and taking a VP. There is this one recommend spot, and unfortunately for the Axis, there are no machine guns covering the middle VP, which is, I feel like, a mistake. There's only the infantry support gun, which is going to be good at dealing with this rifleman squad, especially if it clumps up like this. However, there is an SU-76 doing some barrages against the area, so it might actually be wiped by a lucky shot. And actually, a Stuka will come down and destroy the SU-76. So that was a pretty good Stuka barrage. I mean, the Stuka is already up to Vet 1 with 7 kills, so pretty good play on that. Now, good mine placement by Bert on the left side of the map actually deals a little bit of engine damage to the T-34, which is going to mean that the T-34 not only is revealed to the Germans, because of course taking a little bit of damage, will reveal it on the map, and so now the Germans know that the Soviets are at tier 4, and perhaps there's going to be a Katyusha coming on the field soon enough, or perhaps some Su-85, so that gives information to the German players. That's also going to delay the entrance of the T-34 into the fight by a little bit, because it's going to be repaired, so that's a really good deal overall for free munitions for the German players. Now, there is a Panzer IV Vet 2 on the right side of the map, and it's going to actually be able to wipe out a sniper that, like, Pony's going for now. I feel like the sniper was not exactly the best decision at this point in the game, but the sniper was probably meant for a sort of a recon slash MG, sort of MG denial role. As in, I'm going to, you know, use the sniper's line of sight and flares to, by the way, this Puma is very lucky that that attack round actually hit under the Puma and not the Puma itself, was just short falling of the Puma itself. Very lucky there. And at this point, also the captain, was it wiped? No, very lucky that it was able to escape with one member from the Obersoldan. Obersoldan, they're at 18 kills, but they're taking a lot of damage from this T-34. Again, the T-34, very effective against them, because you don't want to be anywhere near that, as well as this Panzer IV veteran C2 with a machine gun, very effective against infantry. You don't want to be anywhere near that, and the Vet 1 stolen machine gun by the partisans is in very big jeopardy right now, because the Panzer IV is chasing it. However, at this point, the Panzer IV doesn't really, and rightfully so, doesn't really feel like chasing, especially because there's a lot of allied forces around here. There could be anti-tank guns, there could be mines, there could be tank destroyers, so pretty good decision to actually just fall back a little bit, and it's actually going to be in time to prevent the harassment from these penal battalions trying to harass the fuel point, which is actually has actually been in the control of the Germans for a long time. And Bert, despite the fact that he's flowing a huge amount of manpower, he's still sort of leading the way in terms of the fuel game, because he's going to have the King Tiger on out soon enough. He needs pretty much just a little bit of extra fuel, and it's going to be on the field if the Axis can keep that the same map control going for a few minutes. It's going to be pretty much 4 minutes until the King Tiger hits the field, so that's going to be considering, of course, the build time. So this is going to be really good. Wait, the King Tiger doesn't have a build time anymore. Never mind. So it's going to be around two to three minutes, considering the current map control. Now, of course, this is going to be a really bad thing for the Allies, but we do see the possible Pershing is going to be on the field soon enough, because Havok only needs 6 more fuel, and he does have the manpower ready to call in the Pershing. He has chosen the Heavy Cavalry Company. At this point, I feel like only the Pershing is going to be used out of this Heavy Cavalry Company. Maybe some off-map smoke, and maybe he can amass like a huge amount of munitions, some combined arms. But still, already the Pershing is good enough for the Heavy Cavalry Company pick to be justified, so that's really no problem in picking it so late. Now, of course, the Allies do definitely need at this point to get some map control back under their belt, because right now it's pretty much been their Achilles heel for this entire game. They had a little bit of a bright moment in the mid game where they were able to push with their infantry before the Panzer IV came out. Panzer IV has been devastating to the Allied infantry, 22 kills, along with these machine guns that have been constantly rebuilt despite their losses. That's pretty damn good for the Germans. We do see some railway artillery support, and actually an excellent crushing maneuver from the T-34 wipes out a full Vet-5 Volksgrenadier, along with the support of the main gun of the T-34, of course, and the engineers coming in to assist. Of course, the Puma actually also going down from the SU-76s. One SU-76 is actually at Vet-3, and right now I'm not sure where the artillery is being called down, but oh, it looks like over here. But that was definitely a waste of 200 munitions for Fian, so that's actually going to be pretty damn bad for him, because the munitions are very important to the Osttruppen Doctrine to use the artillery officer abilities, to use the Panzerfaust, and to use the Teller Mines, which are also crucial to using, this, for example, this pack gun effectively. Now, finally, Fian has gone for a pack gun. I feel like that was a main mistake of him, of his earlier on, to not go for a pack. Very nice first appearance of the Pershing, dealing 8 casualties to the German army and also wiping out a full pioneer squad, so that is already a pretty good thing for the Allies. And we even see a nice harassment maneuver with the captain, thanks to its sprint, able to just cover a lot of distance really quickly around the map and capture the undefended VP on the right side of the map. At the same time, the Allies in, on the minimap, if you've been paying attention, they have managed to capture the left side of the map, and they've actually managed to get a stolen machine gun onto the building to actually defend the fuel point, and sort of that's going to help, because it's sort of going to be attracting a little bit of German attention, and also defending the fuel point means that the Germans are not going to have as much of a fuel superiority as before. Now, Fian has gone for the Tier 4 and the Panther, which is going to be pretty good against the Pershing. However, it's still going to suffer against the Allied infantry, especially against the Partisans. Now, and again, the Partisan MG being really useful. Actually, that was a second stolen MG. Okay. Again, stolen energy is being really useful, not only because of the distraction, but also because it eats a Stuka Barrage. Stuka Barrage, which could have been used, for example, on these repairing Su-76s, if their location was known to the Germans, that would have been a very devastating hit, because it would have wiped out, perhaps, a engineer squad. Actually, they weren't repairing, they were just sitting there with a penal battalion, okay. Still, it would have been pretty devastating on the SU-76s, and it would have given the Stuka a lot of veterancy, because again, the sort of good side of the Stuka barraging some vehicles, especially the lighter armored vehicles such as the Su-76s, is the fact that it can get a lot of experience really quickly, even if it doesn't get kills. So it's a pretty good thing, because the Stuka does have some pretty damn prohibitive experience requirements. Despite their, I believe, there was a patch that reduced the experience requirements for a few of its levels, especially the 4th and the 5th one. Don't quote me on this, I'm pretty sure there was, but yeah. Still, it's a very, very hard unit to vet up. So if the German player can get a nice barrage going on the Su-76, that would be pretty good, because the veterancy on the Stuka is really excellent. If you know, it's got the Vet 2, which reduces the reload time, and also the battery, which improves the maximum range, which means that essentially it becomes a much more effective artillery unit. And now, right now, the Panther is going to be a pretty decent sort of emergency anti-Pershing unit, the best way I can put it, but a pretty damn good actually usage of the Su-76s with the barrages is going to take down not only the PAK-40 but also the MG-42 out of Fian. So that's going to allow the Allied forces to actually move up with a little bit of ease on this flank, which would have been really hard had this pack and this machine gun been operational. However, this Panther is going to pretty much mean that these weapon teams are going to be defended until some kind of German unit can come in to recapture those. And since this is Osttruppen Doctrine, there's going to be plenty of that coming. Now, this one Osttruppen squad is going to attempt to harass the right side fuel point, and it's going to take a lot of damage and possibly be wiped by the captain and these rear echelons. Rearchelon with Minesweeper is actually making sure that the S-Minefield, which is smartly placed by Fian, is not going to be too much of a danger to the Allied infantry. Actually, two engineers capping is a little bit of a mistake. This one engineer could be sent in against the fuel point to capture doubly as quick. And also the T-34 could be used with the secure mode to capture, which is something that I feel like Lyconius should have been using a lot more, because remember, these T-34s are pretty quick, pretty replaceable, and then once they get that bed one, having them able to use the capturing ability means that they're pretty much going to be immune to the cheeky machine gun that some players like to sort of place near VPs near the end of the game to sort of make sure that no random unit comes in to harass it, which is a really good thing for the Soviet players, actually, who use that sort of advantage to their advantage. The fact that they can use that T-34, or perhaps even that T-70 if it's still alive, to have that quick sort of quick capping unit to their disposal. Now, good push by the Americans actually takes out the PAC-40 again. PAC-40 was a little bit out of position, too far ahead of the machine gun's range, so the riflemen were easily able to hide at this point of the battlefield and snipe out the PAC. They were also able to sort of flank around the machine gun and flip a nice grenade, actually completely wiping the squad and the weapon. So that's going to be a really bad thing for Fian, because right now he's pretty low on manpower. He's got 200 fuel, but no manpower to actually replace it, which is usually a thing that happens to the Americans. However, it's not something that's happening to Havoc right now, and that's partially due to his excellent sort of control of his riflemen. He hasn't taken big losses in any engagements so far. He's only lost, I believe, one rifleman squad? Or am I tripping balls? I'm pretty sure I'm tripping balls. No, that's... I hate this sometimes. He's lost two riflemen, actually. Wow, I did not... Actually, I did not see one of those. Okay, so he's lost two riflemen squads, but still. The ones that he was unfortunate enough to lose, he was able to replace with equally vetted up units and equally upgraded units, thanks to his pretty decent unit control. However, one big advantage of the Allies right now, coming into this late game, is not only the ability to pop out rocket artillery such as this Katyusha in a sort of more quicker fashion than the Germans, because the Germans have to use the sort of clumsier sometimes Stuka, because the Stuka firing in a line comparatively to the Katyusha firing in a circle is sometimes harder to use. Of course, there's the fact that the Katyusha is a little bit RNG dependent as well. The Stuka can be RNG dependent as demonstrated right now, but still, it's not nearly as much as the Katyusha. So, again, back to the point. Not only the fact that they can use the Katyusha from the Soviets, and the Soviets can use the T-34 cab, is an advantage for them, but also the spy network from the partisans pretty much means that even in the late game, this commander stays very relevant because of the fact that the spy network is going to mean that if the allied players are indeed cooperating and communicating on some kind of voice chat channel, they are going to be able to know where the German units are because of the spy network. However, the Panther, and oh, looks like a Panzerfaust or a mine hit the Pershing, and since its the engine is damaged right now, it's in a pretty damn shitty position. Very lucky that these shots were bouncing off the front armor. However, there's actually a Sherman coming in to support, and there is the marked vehicle coming in from the Soviet player, which is exactly what the Americans were needing. Nice support from the partisan player. Partisans will actually be spawned from the shack over here. AT partisans, in fact, are spawned, and they will be able to probably snare the Panther with an AT grenade along with the Pershing facing its frontal armor and taking a lot of damage. But unfortunately, the last shot before the Panther dies will destroy the Pershing, along with the Sherman going down at the same time, and the Panther being destroyed by the Su-76s, along with the Soviet partisans, along with more partisans coming in. Only a tad bit too late to save the Sherman from the PAC-40 anti-tank gun, which is going to be saved in its veterancy by the machine gun that was positioned by Fian to protect the rear. What the fight! Incredibly weird and incredibly deadly for both sides. However, at this point, it's good for the Germans, because the Germans still have this King Tiger on the field, which hasn't participated in the fight, and its entire and during the entire fight, it was just busy pummeling American infantry into submission in the center VP, it looks like, because that is a BAR on the ground, and perhaps that's the captain? No, that wasn't the captain. That was a rifleman squad, a vet-free rifleman squad going down, and right now, that's not good, because it's going to be much harder for Havoc to replace his losses right now. He has lost pretty much 230 plus 110 yes, fuel worth of units, so that's 340. And at this point, the Soviets have also lost their Bet-3 Su-76, along with the Shtuka once again being able to escape from a very weird sort of positioning, and there's also a Shtuka on the field. What? I feel like Fiend went for the Desperation Stu at this point. He was probably going for... I'm not sure if it was actually because he had the resources to replace... I feel like it was to actually just fail out his pop cap when he had the Panther and the Panzer IV. But at this point, since there's no Panzer and the Panzer IV, the main usage of the Shtug is going to be as a sort of supportive unit to the King Tigra, and which is going to be pretty effective, I feel like. Now, finally, I can talk a little bit about the Infrared Path Rack, what I call the Map Hack. Because it's pretty much a legal map pack, along with the Spy Network. It's one of the many map packs that are present in Company of Heroes 2. The other notable ones being the 2-2-2 with the spotting scope, and the T-70 with Vet 2 and Recon mode, which is not nearly as effective as the Vet 2 scout car with the scope, but it's still pretty damn map hacky. And also sometimes the vehicle detection from the German advanced armor. Rather, elite armor doctrine, but that's only for vehicles. Actually, pretty decent usage of attack round from the flamers, attack rounding through the smoke. Of course, at the same time, pretty good usage of the grenades, but it's going to be pretty well dodged by the artillery officer. Artillery officer actually take the only casualty being the artillery officer himself, because as you can see, you cannot use the abilities when the officer himself is dead and only his grenadier guards are alive, so it's pretty much a three-man grenadier squad. At this point, artillery officer still alive with Vet 3 and 22 kills. I'm not sure, but looks like capacity to lead. I'm guessing that's a buff to the buffs that he gives to other units. Now, very dangerous shot from the Sherman, actually deals a lot of damage to the artillery officer. A Sherman from Havoc is a really weird decision. He could have gone for a Pershing. He would have been at 160 fuel at this point. And he would have been 4 minutes away from a Pershing. That is a really weird decision from him. I feel like that could cost the Allies the game, that cost the Allies the chance to come back into this game. Because right now they do have a double cap going, and they had a triple cap brief. Well, they had Nooch going briefly on the Northern VP, but it's going to be recaptured by this machine gun. Again. That is really weird. The Allies could have had a big chance had they just waited a little bit on the Pershing. They could have gotten the Pershing out. They could have relied on the Soviet units to be a stopgap measure, especially the Su-85, which was built by Lykonius, which is, I feel like, something that he should have done earlier, because Su-85 is very effective, especially after the last bash where it got buffed. On this map, it is really good with its sort of long line of sight. Now, the Katyusha is a little bit too exposed on the field, and Birch has actually finally gone for a doctrine, the Breakthrough Doctrine, to actually partially, I believe, use Breakthrough tactics and get out the Panzerfusiliers. Panzerfusiliers being a very effective infantry squad with the G43s, even without Verency, but especially with Verency, they just become Terminators. So in these late game engagements, they're going to be fairly easy to vet up if they can get the upgrade with the G43, and they can do a lot of damage against these sort of lower quality allied units, especially the Soviet ones. However, the reason I say that the breakthrough tactics might have been a big part as to why the... come on, use secure mode! Use secure mode, Lykonius! Excellent, finally! I love secure mode, it is one of my favorite... I'm a Soviet player, in case you know. And it is one of my favorite things to do. Now, a nice wipe on the Rifleman in the center. Unfortunate for Havoc, he wasn't able to retrieve them in time. Actually, a Katyusha will wipe out a Panzer Grenadier squad at the same time. 12 VPs are left for the Allies, and they definitely need to capture this one point. Pretty much at this moment, and they will be able to nuke it, but unfortunately this captain is under fire from a King Tiger, so I don't feel like he will survive long enough to actually get the capture going, and especially because the artillery officer comes in, some smoke from the allies actually comes in at the same time, and a nice attack round shot from the King Tiger actually wipes the captain, very luckily for the allies. Now, Shtug actually wipes the Su-85 somehow. The Su-85 must have been at very low HP. So, very lucky for the Shtug to actually get that very crucial AI tank out of the way. And now the T-34 has finished the capture. It's going to actually be used in some other way with its secure mode being available. 5 VPs left for the Allies. They do have the central point neutralized. the left VP is under their control, and the right side VP is about to be sort of attacked by a Sherman. Interestingly enough, the Sherman can actually get its crew out and cap just as well as the T-34 can. Of course, if some kind of German unit does approach the crew while it's out, that's pretty bad because they might actually get damaged down below free men, and free men is the limit at which the American crews can crew a Sherman. So that would be pretty bad for the Sherman crew. However, the Sherman has managed to circle shift around the pack, but the Panther, or rather the Stug, again, the Stug hero somehow, gets another vehicle kill under its belt. It's got... Wait, what? I'm guessing that was the King Tiger then that killed the... No? What killed this? It must have been a mine. I feel like that was a mine. It's just my gut feeling. Either the Stuka barrage, which would have been really weird, or a mine combined with the shoot shot killed the Su-85. That's really weird. So now again, another Sherman in the center. Again, Havoc would have had a Pershing by now had he gone for that. And actually, the Allies put on the Katyusha barrage right at the center VP, which is, I feel like, a weird decision. Why wouldn't Lyconius wait for the machine gun position to be revealed to then barrage the machine gun is just beyond me. Now, there are a couple of Soviet T-34s pushing up, along with a very heavily damaged Sherman, trying to destroy the Stuka, actually, and they will succeed taking out the Stuka. The King Tiger does have a marked vehicle on it. Unfortunately, the Allies were not able to capitalize upon that, and the King Tiger will only be a little bit damaged. Right now, the Allies do have the control of the center VP. The Sherman, using its smoke along with the Allied off-smoke barrage from the Heavy Cavalry Company, again, being used to great effect to destroy and disorient the Allied, or rather the German forces. This Panther is in a very, very bad way. It's being hit by 80 partisans spawned by this building. Again, that's why the partisans are so very dangerous. And at the same time, the other T-34 was taken out by the Stug, again, Stug hero, along with perhaps the King Tiger helping up and the, maybe some, I don't know, maybe something else. I don't even know anymore. This is so very weird and completely insane. Now, there is a Panzerstreck on the ground, which these Pioneers are going to be able to pick up. Again, both sides, for once, really, really good at picking up the stuff that's on the ground. Now, this one Reckenriffer, it's not being picked up because these riflemen need to be at full strength to repulse any kind of German infantry attack, and also because it's at very low HP, so I feel like picking it up would be very dangerous for anyone. Now, a Ranger squad will actually be called in to fight on the right side of the map. Now, on the right side, Havoc, for whatever, you know, mistakes he's made in the center, losing a few rifleman squads here and there because of the sort of late-game clusterfuck things that happen, one really, 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 really important contribution that he's made to the Allied war effort right now is the fact that he has sort of continuously harassed the right side of the map. And right now his Rangers may actually be able to capture the right side VP because he's going to be able to get down the very quickly firing off-max smoke barrage in down on the point. Unfortunately for him, a Panzer Grenadier squad will be smartly repositioned freshly off the map and actually off the... Leicht Mechanized Company, with the sort of newly built Panzer Grenadiers, he's going to be able to wipe out the Rangers and secure the right side VP. At the center VP, there's also a lot of action going on. Something fired a lot of smoke, which is lagging my computer a lot. Perhaps the artillery officer, perhaps something else. The artillery officer is in full retreat, and I feel like that's the only thing that could have caused all the smoke. So, pretty good decision out of that. And unfortunately, for the Germans, the Allies were nicely able to reposition a stolen MG4 deferral onto the capping point just before the Germans were actually able to neutralize it. Unfortunately, the machine gun is going to be destroyed by the King Tiger, which is up to 33 kills. Now, 34? No, it was actually killed by something else. I'm not sure. Now, there is still a vet-free stolen MG42. It's still the partisan HMG, which has 8 kills and vet-free. Unfortunately, the partisan HMG is going to be destroyed by the King Tiger. Of course, the Allies are still trying to actually capture the right side with a smoke-using vehicle crew jumping out Sherman. And right now, the Stug is trying desperately to run over the vehicle crew, along with the machine gun finally getting through the smoke and managing to suppress the vehicle crew. Of course, the vehicle crew has abandoned any hope of actually using the Sherman. They're just trying to get the point as sort of capped as possible. Now, on the left side of the map, there is a nice, actually barred up Sturmpioneer squad with just very nice capturing of the left side, and the T-34 with secure mode is actually going to stop them right before they can get the point capture for the Axis. In the center, the Axis have managed to win the fight, and there's a Panda Fusilier squad capping, but there's an actually Katyusha Barrage along with a Vetfree Rifleman squad coming into cap. At the same time, there is a sort of... Unfortunately, it doesn't look like T-34 came out of the capping zone while having secure mode off. So the capturing of the point was actually complete by the Germans, and the Germans do have the triple cap, and also, despite the fact that there's the smoke and everything, they will be able to, actually with this double cap from the Stern Pioneers, manage to get down the Allied VPs. What a game, incredible. Now, despite the brawls that were happening at the end that were sort of kind of getting my attention a little bit, and actually the officer getting himself a nice toy. So I feel like the officer is coming back to Germany to his wife with a bit of a souvenir. That's interesting. He's gonna have... Okay, let's talk about the mistakes and what could have done better or worse. Now, both teams played very well with their coordination. I feel like none of the of those teams could have sort of coordinated better. I feel like Havoc made the biggest mistakes in the end with going with those desperation Shermans. Now, I completely understand why. I've been in the same situation and I've done the same. However, I feel like if he had just waited and gone for another Pershing and he played a little bit more patiently, along with his allies' very numerous tier 4 units that he had on the field. I mean, the Su-76s were in tier 4 units, but he had two of those, and two of those are pretty effective at the sort of later game tank battles anyway because of their excellent gun, despite their sort of weak armor and weak HP. They're still pretty effective, along with, like, at one point, Lyconius had two T-34s, but I'm pretty sure, sort of in total, he has built, like, three T-34s at least. Let me actually just check. T-34-76? No, he's only produced two. So again, even better. He had a lot of presence with those two T-34s. One of them was lost, very unfortunately, in a sort of kind of a reckless push against the Germans. And again, one those reckless dives, along with the reckless Shermans, who did a lot of the reckless diving, I feel like were the main contributors to the sort of Allied sort of half success in the late game, in that they were very effective in their aggressiveness, their just sheer shock that was able to throw back the Germans in quite a lot of sort of occasions, but not completely break them in any sort of form. Because yes, Fian took a lot of losses on the right side of the map with that engagement with the Pershing, and he in general took a lot of losses to his infantry because again, he's Ostrup and he's going to take a lot of losses. And his weapon teams were constantly being decrewed by the Allies. But he was always able to sort of hold together a force, hold together, manage to recapture the weapon teams pretty much all the time. And he was able to always come back, always support Bert, who had the sort of held the main line in the center and the left with the King Tiger, with the... map hack with the Stuka, which at the end only was able to be destroyed, despite the fact that Bert was playing really aggressively with it. So I feel like part of what the Allies should have done is focused a little bit more of their insane aggressive diving on taking out the rocket artillery that ended up getting like 30 kills, I feel like. I'm not sure if it's going to show up in the stats. No, only the Fuchs Grenadiers and the Stern Pioneers. But again, let's see how much efficiency it had. Probably a lot. And again, I'm checking a lot the stats because, yeah, 439, which for an artillery unit, it's pretty decent. And look at that vehicle damage. It did a lot of vehicle damage because, again, those Su-76s that are pretty vulnerable to the rocket artillery are going to take a lot of losses with the sort of well-placed barrages. Now, again, I was checking a lot of stats because a lot more than I'm used to because, again, the game was just so intense that I could not sort of analyze things as they were going, so I just need a little bit of help. I'm sorry. Now, definitely the right side harassment of Havoc was really, really on point. And also of Fian. Fian was at this point pretty much all game. Whenever it was under the control of the Allies, Fian had some Ostrupen squad or the officer or the Pioneers on point harassing the right side fuel. which was crucial because it delayed the Pershing, it delayed the Su-85s, it delayed the Katyusha long enough for the Germans to recover from their sort of mid-game slump that they had, because they really had a really bad time once the Allied infantry really started to kick in with their sort of early game advantage, mid-game advantage with their early veterancy, early weapons, and such. And that allowed the Germans a lot more time to recover, a lot of time for Bert to get out that King Tiger, which got 41 kills, a lot of time for Fien to get out the Panzer IV, which was incredibly effective. It got like 25 kills, something like that. And just really nice play from both sides. Unfortunately, at the end, the Germans were able to prevail because I feel like the Allies dropped the ball in the later stages a little bit, which is something that a lot of Allied players do later on. If they're not going for the sort of artillery spam tactics of just having like four calliopes and four land mattresses or something, which is something that some people do. And okay, those Allied players play very defensively. However, if it's a Pershing player plus a Soviet player, it does tend to come down to a lot of you probably should not have rushed into all those German units. Which, again, it's pretty easy to say when you're just looking at a replay and seeing all the units that are amassed in one area, like in that huge charge at the center, or that huge charge against the Panther and the Pershing at the right side of the map. You can see those things a lot more clearly, so it's a little bit unfair to the players. But at the same time, they should have played a little bit more defensively, especially since Lyconius, and now I'm going to stop after this one last comment, Lyconius focused a lot on tank destroyers, which usually means a little bit more of a defensive playstyle, which is excellent with the Katyusha. The Katyusha, it's a pretty decent rocket artillery vehicle, despite its sort of shitty accuracy, especially at the longer ranges. However, it was still pretty effective. It got 11 kills into two levels of experience. So I feel like if Lyconius and Havoc had played just a little tiny bit more defensively, they would have lost a little bit more points part of the way through. But if they had focused a little bit more, because again, the harassment of the right side is excellent, but at one point Havoc was focusing his Pershing and his Shermans and a lot of effort on the right side of the map, along with supporting riflemen coming in for the munitions points and all the likes. So I feel like if they had focused on the sort of southern flank a little bit more, focused on holding one VP, focused on just chipping away at the Germans with their tank destroyers, with their Pershing, which is excellent at the poking game, with their its long range, with excellent anti-infantry capacity, trying to get a little bit more wipes against Bert, because yes, there were a lot of wipes against Fien, but Bert, for the majority of the game, was able to hold his veteran 5 Volksgrenadiers. Only at the end, he was pretty much forced to throw them in and lose them. I feel like they would have been in a little bit of a better position. But now, finally, I can stop this madness. I can stop this cast. I want to thank you all for watching. I hope you enjoyed this 2v2. I hope you learned something from it, and I'll see you soon.